Pleasure to see you all back. And if you're coming, this is the first day, then welcome to the conference. We are already late by 1 minute, so I don't want to take too much time. Really happy to have Dave Thomas here. We've been trying many years to get him here, and finally we've been able to get him. So I'll give it to Dave Thomas from here.
Thank you, Naresh. It's an honor to be here, and I just want to say something about Naresh, because I think the reason that many of the speakers are here, and I'm sure many of you, is because Naresh and a few other individuals in your wonderful country invested their personal time to try and make sure that the job of building software could be better, more interesting, and you could be continuously learning. So I don't have a chance to thank him, so I wonder if you would join me in thanking Naresh and his team for this wonderful conference. He's truly an outstanding software engineer and recognized around the world. And I think many of us are happy to try and arrange our fairly busy travel schedules because we know how important this event is and events like this in our respective countries. Community matters, and community makes things much different. It overcomes the blockages that exist between companies and creates new opportunities. So thanks to the team here. So I'm going to be talking about value-driven development. If you abbreviate that to VDD, it's probably not a good thing to do. It's not a new brand, and it's certified certification free. I'm in a previous life, and still a university professor, so I'm used to provoking students and irritating them. So I may say some things for the point of view of making you think. You don't need to be confused that I'm actually correct in anything I'm saying. But hopefully they'll make you think about things a little differently, since that's kind of the job for a keynote speaker. And as you found out from Josh and his very progressive work in modern agile. The outline for the talk, since I'm at the beginning of the scaling session, and in a previous life, I did a lot of very large scale agile transitions, some with thousands of employees globally. But by many companies that specialize by doing something stupid like putting half the team in India and keeping the people who held all the knowledge in other countries like Europe and America. I was pleased to hear last night at dinner talking to people that some people are smart enough to realize that Lean says whole team, whole team. Clearly we're making some progress, but some of you may work in organizations that need to learn that. I can assure you those of us that are working with your colleagues in America are telling them how stupid it is to split teams across geographies. But we have many good speakers to talk about that later. Please do make America.com. So I'm going to talk first about a little bit about scaling. Then I'll talk about process-driven development. Then I'll talk about value-driven development, because that's really the focus. So the question is, can you scale agile? And the answer is, we know we can. It's pretty simple to do, provided you have a few ingredients. The first is strong, consistent, and respected leadership. We have a hard time doing that for our countries, let alone for our businesses. I'm Canadian, so there may be a bit more humor in this talk than American speaking. The business needs to go from talking about projects to products. Lean is fundamentally about how you build products. So if you still talk about projects, I'm sorry, you're unlikely to be very successful in your journey other than having many, many scrum teams and not much difference. If you don't begin by putting in continuous integration and delivery and a system that can measure everything, then you can't improve it. Again, the basic Lean principle, if you can't measure it, you can't improve it. This is why Scrum has almost no impact if you don't have a measurement system. And the other thing that many people don't realize is that if you want to sustain high quality in engineering, you have to have people connect as leaders and mentors and communities of practice. These are found in the best companies in the world. And when I was at IBM, we put in something called the distinguished engineer role, where a senior technical person can work without staff or with a small staff or managing a large product team and be paid at the level of a vice president or an executive. These people are key to the successful development of software in the parts of the world where I've worked. Just a disclaimer, I'm a product person. I have a lot of experience working in large IT companies, all painful and unsuccessful, or less successful than I would hope. There's a lot of rhetoric about emergent leadership and so on in the Agile Bible. Unfortunately, it doesn't either contain the Old Testament or the rest of the New Testament. It just contains the simple part, the Ten Commandments, or maybe it's 12 for XP. But it's very simple that success in any organization that I've worked in depends on leadership, because leadership is the foundation of trust and respect. And leaders have these qualities. I realize the slides are probably too small for you, and I'll save you reading them, but you get the deck. But the most important thing is leaders have time to listen. They're not always busy. They don't spend their time going to meetings. Now, the performance metric that I like is 1/meetings. If you go than more than one a year, your bonus starts going down. Death by Meetings is a wonderful book. And I have a quote from a very good friend, Nigel Dalton, who, if you've ever seen the wonderful work at Lonely Planet, where the lawyers, the accountants, everyone in the business worked with cards and put them on the wall. And it was absolutely fantastic. And I was there in February one year, and I said, Nigel, he just succeeded in getting the UX people to put up, because the UX people never wanted to put their stuff up until it was done. Because they didn't really want anyone to comment. They would user test it in their own silo. But there's silos. And the big thing that he came across, I said, Nigel, what happens if you're not here? And he said, Dave, agile is fragile. 6 months later, the BBC changed the management, and Lonely Planet went from being the best exemplar of agile in the world to, like the rest of people, mediocre agile. The people sustained it and so on, but the leadership, which is so critical, the person who had those values, who had the trust, was gone. Agile is really hard. It's really hard on leaders. They have to deal with problems every day to try and move things out of the way. And it's very difficult to sustain this leadership. And he's now CIO of realestate.com, where there's 800 people doing amazing things with Agile. But I fear that if Nigel were to leave there, the same thing would happen. What this tells me is that scaling and systematic transformation is a problem. If you want to talk more about your individual problems on scaling, I'm filling in for a speaker who couldn't make it this afternoon. And you can bring your questions about scaling in your organization or your friend's organization, because you wouldn't want to ask a question about your organization, but you know someone that's scaling and they need some help. If you bring those along, I'll talk a little bit about Agile and Large, but I don't want to talk. I really want to talk about your questions. So that's not my talk today, so I'll move along. The other question is that scaling, in my view, should not be a goal. Systematic transformation is a good way to waste a lot of money and energy across a large organization and get very little result. Often it doesn't. I mean, if you're going to scale hundreds of thousands, I worked in organizations with, 15,000 employees building software, right? You might as well get a hose and spray them with Agile holy water, right? Here you go, you're blessed, you become Agile, right? You're smoking dope if you think this is going to work. I understand there are a few amazing people who can do this, right? Evan's amazing, he can work in this. There are people who can do this, but they're outstanding leaders. And as soon as you lose that, you lose the whole thing. And it's very, very hard. Dee Huck is an example of a person who transformed a company that Joshua mentioned yesterday. But there aren't thousands of them. There aren't hundreds of them. There's probably 10, 20, in the world at any point in time. The other problem is that, you know, when you go to process-driven development, you basically end up with a small improvement. But you see, the CEO, when you told them agile, what they heard was agility. And you were so enthusiastic to tell them to get going with agile, the CEO said, well, Naresh, is this going to give me, you know, productivity and cost saving? You know, because if not, I don't think we should go with this agile stuff. And then that moment of weakness, because you thought it would be so good for the company, you went, yes. And you lied. Because the agile contract, other than it violated by Jeff Sutherland and unsubstantiated by any proof, does not give you productivity. That's not the contract. The contract is a better working environment, predictable delivery, and quality. That's not what executives care about as a first order bit. They want to have that, but only if they get the other stuff they want, which is productivity or cost saving. So fundamentally, the agile contract doesn't deliver. And the expense on systematic change, in my view, is poorly placed. So this is just an example of the kind of CIOs I meet, and basically, they have a CEO all-hands meeting, and everybody comes in here, and basically, the message here, without going into the specific words, is, okay, we've given you everything. We gave you objects. You know, maybe we gave you Scala, whatever it is, your favorite language, your favorite tools. We gave you your favorite process. We've done all these things. We even changed your space. You know, people renovate their whole buildings to get this amazing space, right? And does the output change? Usually no. It's better quality, probably 30%, which is significant for people that have below 30% in quality, which is the average in IT shops. And so basically his message is, guys, we've done everything we can for you, but we need to be faster at executing high-value projects or high-value products. We need to turn up the dials on productivity while maintaining quality and features. And at that point, the tape self-destructs, as in Mission Impossible, because this is your job. How can we make a change where we deliver substantially more value faster? Because in the end, what people really want is better, cheaper, faster, and good enough. Look, we use the web. 404 is good enough for everything. We just throw code at it. We finally found a business solution where we can ship lousy software continuously. And the badge of honor is how much junk can you ship today? That's called continuous delivery in many cases. And the measure becomes the metric of how many releases do I do, not did I actually deliver value to the customer. This is a serious, serious problem. And as companies decide that they want to look more like the California web companies, they take themselves on a very dangerous journey. Because the California web companies are in a very different kind of situation with regard to the people they have, the small business problems they're solving. In this, you know, Netflix is an amazing business. I'm sure you've heard Adrian talk about his experience as CTO. But the business is actually fairly simple, right? You select the movie, you know, they charge you for it, and they deliver it. And they do the delivery through a separate channel, so they don't use the cloud for any of that. So it's an amazing story, but the business is actually dead simple. Unfortunately, you know, boring things like insurance and healthcare and things like that, which actually matter, are much harder and much more complicated. And we get this model that you can take whatever happens in California and just do it in your shop. And this is a very, very naive and a very dangerous thing. So basically, what the CEO is saying here is we need to focus on value. We need to change our practices. How many of you are still programming with object technology? And how many of you are still programming pre-object technology? And the rest of you don't want to say because you don't want to put your hands up. Who in here uses property-based testing? Who in here knows what it is? Folks, Agile is 20 years old. Objects are almost 50 years old. We need to move on. You're not using best practices. You're using yesterday's practices. You have to be responsible for picking up the new practice. You can't expect your corporation to do everything yourself. For them, you have to do things yourself. We need to look at these new practices. And we need to get rid of everything that's slow, because those things block us. That may mean your entire production department, which is a challenge in a large organization. You need to be able to fail fast. So that means you need an environment where you can experiment and deploy quickly, but also pull it out when it doesn't work. So value-driven development, basically, I've been building software for a long time. You can tell by how old I am. And this is kind of my secret for how I do it. I never did it the way I said I did it, but that's what you're supposed to say, because otherwise all your competitors figure out how you do it. But basically, I never actually believed in building software the way people said, because it was just too hard. I'm not that smart. There are all these really smart people in California, and they're very scary smart. So you can't possibly be off in the boondocks in Canada and build successful software. I mean, it's just not possible, unless you cheat. So you have to find some hack, which we'll call it. So I'm really going to share with you my hacks for how to get things done. And the reason that people let us use any programming language or tool or practice they want is not because they actually believe the tool or practice is any good, but because we ship. We guarantee the software we build will deliver on time, or they don't pay us for it. It was a clever thing we did when we started doing business. We didn't actually know how hard it was. But it's, you know, like the great story about the basketball team, you know, cutting down the net. We just started saying, look, you know, if it doesn't arrive on time, you don't pay for it. We did have a few painful experiences where we didn't get paid, but we learned how to do it. And contrary to no estimates, we actually teach people how to be really good at estimating. Because when you deliver things on time for a fixed price, you have to be really good at estimating. So we invested a lot of time in continuous estimation. So what we really want to do is find a quick way to figure out where the value is in a system, validate it at scale, because everyone knows you can prototype a wonderful new technology solution easily, but when you go to lean on it, it doesn't quite hold up. I can remember a client, their whole business was based on a website, and a wonderful new young man came in and with his team, showed them how they could use this wonderful new JavaScript framework. And he built the best demo, and they let him go to the board. And enthusiastically, he told the board how he could have this done in 6 months, and this would take the company out of this huge hole. And he did have it done in 6 months, except you couldn't lean on it. And the system crashed under load, and the company lost hundreds of millions of dollars. So it's great to have a new idea, but you have to validate it at scale. This is a critical part of the process. The other thing is we don't want to work on anything that we can't deliver in less than 3 or 4 months. In other words, we're looking for the shortest time to value, because that's the way the corporation thinks. If you can do something for a corporation in a quarter, you're a hero. If you can't, you're a schmuck. So you might as well drive to what the real goal is, which is getting something significant done every quarter. If you can't do that, go someplace else, find another project you can do where you can. So to get management buy-in and mitigate risk, you have to have strong senior sponsors. And that's a longer talk about how you do that. You have to have a clear, tangible, and measurable goal, ideally in dollars or throughput or something like that, that you can measure, so you can actually guarantee that you can test the business value, you can show it. You have to have a model that shows that you're going to produce significant business value, ideally something over 25 or 30%, but nothing less than 15. Have to be implemented quickly, and you have to be minimally disruptive on existing operations. Because most large corporations have a lot of systems that are making them money. Those are the ones written in the languages you don't like to program in. But they're the ones that are working while your new software isn't. Right? Legacies are great because they make the money. The rewrite of a legacy is where we waste a lot of money. So the challenge is, how can we insert this stuff in the right place? Because we're not going to rewrite anything significant in 3 months. So there's a set of activities that can do this. There's a set of technical challenges. We need a small team with the right skills. We need a whole team. We're going to work, you know, if we're going to be working with SAP BW, somebody knows how that has to know how that mother works, right? Because there's going to be a billion tables in SAP BW, and you have to know how HANA works or the previous version works. So you really need a trained killer in SAP BW. So you have to have the right thing. So sometimes, contrary to the agile religion, specialists do matter. You know, if you're going to really do something where you have to go and insert a small amount of explosive in the middle of SAP BW to get what you need to go in there with someone who knows how to do it, and so the two of you can die together when it blows up in the wrong place. And the odds of that are unfortunately fairly high. So you have to invest in live backup technologies, which are not available. If you ever tried developing for SAP BW, the whole process of, you know, I mean, configuration management, this is an absolute nightmare. You know, the old prod, blah, blah. We have one client that has 13 systems that you have to release through to get, they have 13 prods. I'm in prod. Well, you're not in the real one. Then you're in the next one. Then you're in the next one. Terrible. So you know, just trying to get the thing released could take you 3 months. So you need to have straightforward deployment, minimum dependencies. So some of the techniques we use for doing this, and this isn't all of them, I just want to talk about some of these things. And for some of you that are post-technical, which is something I hope I never am, this may go by you, but you know, please listen to your troops if they start talking about some of these things and say, we want to try some of these, because these are, to me, the kind of secret weapons for attacking some of these problems. Many of them are quite old. Everyone knows about microservices, right? And process. So what you have is you have all these little processes, and they connect through data flows, and they all run concurrently. Isn't that really cool? You ever talk to your dad or your granddad, and he did something called structured analysis and design, data flow diagrams? Take a look at your microservice architecture. What Fred George does is sell people data flow diagrams to execute. The only people in the world who made sense are the Japanese banks, who figured out when they were doing COBOL not to throw away the data flow, but to actually build an execution infrastructure where the processes actually run. So for 30 years, they've been running microservices in a mainframe. Sometimes the old ideas come back, and then they become really cool, until they complicate them with all the extra stuff that the new smart people have to bring. So envisioning. There's one thing that's been the most significant thing for me and for the teams that I've worked in different companies. It's basically figuring out how not to build software. How can we write less code? And so the most important thing, and this all comes from product design. One of the unfortunate things about Agile is it took some of the simplest thing from Lean, the workflow things, I took from a small part of Lean, but it left out a whole lot of things in product design. So if you happen to accidentally have done anything in product engineering, you would actually know about all these things: market analysis, technology evaluation, delta competitive analysis, QFD, health of quality, and so on. But unfortunately, they're hardly talked about in the Agile community or the Lean software community. Product engineering has been doing these things. Integrated product teams have existed for many, many years, and Toyota in the early 80s was the key model for these things, and much of the work there comes from. So the key thing here is that you find a way to fail fast. So envisioning what we do is try and build the product as quickly as we can out of the simplest thing we can use. Paper, the competitor's product by marking up the competitor's product. That's often one of the best ways, right? One of the best ways to write product requirements, you want to write the stories, it's really easy. You take the three products that you want to compete against, delta the features from those, it's called delta analysis, and then you basically go and say, okay, now we got our spec. We want to be able to take these three guys out of the market in that order. This one's the one that's just above us, we'll take him out, then we'll go and take the next one out, then we'll take the next one out. That is a story of IBM Java. And it clicks. Goodbye, semantic, goodbye. Until there was only two players left in the market. So this is sort of an example. I mean, the classic problem when you want to build a calculator is that we all know about the waterfall pitfall and analysis, and you get this huge, huge calculator that you can't carry. So the alternative, of course, is you get the Bob Martin calculator, right, where you sit there and you write a unit test, and you, oh, look at this. Hey, I got this thing done, and it does plus. Isn't that cool? Yeah, well, it took that time. And I have to go to, I have to build plastics for it and everything else. Well, it's a part of a product. Well, that's not going to be too good. Well, I want times. Oh, no problem. We'll go back into another cycle, and we'll build you another wrong thing because it'll be missing divide. You need a sense of the whole. This is just too expensive. Writing unit tests is a huge waste of time relative to writing acceptance tests. Unit tests are for programmers that can't program. Class tests or component tests or acceptance tests are for customers and programmers that want to build and integrate systems. And not to say that unit tests, like story points, are training wheels. The problem is, how long are you going to be on that stupid training bicycle? Someday we'll actually teach you how to really estimate in units that people understand, like dollars and time, the way the business works. Not going around talking about points and velocity, which is a measure of nothing. You know, throw your velocity diagrams out and put in cumulative flow diagrams at least. Read flow. That's probably the only good lean book on software that's deep. Lots of good inspirational books. So what we want is something that lets us quickly build something that looks like the calculator very quickly so we can find out it's wrong and so we can show it to the customer and interact with them. How does this work in practice? This is a very large system. It happens to be an IBM product now. It basically looks at websites globally and essentially audits the website for security, 508 compliance, checks all sorts of things for corporate websites. It's a wonderful piece of Canadian engineering. And has a UI that was built by a Canadian engineer. It really sucks. Yeah. I mean, you would not, this is the UI from hell. But the back end is amazing. You wouldn't have any products like that, but we do in Canada. And so the challenge was rebuild this. Now, of course, while they were fighting over which UI framework to work, and there was no one to talk to, and which technology to build it in, we had one person who was in our envisioning team, and basically they went out and built a low-fidelity prototype. Those little red dots are things you can click on. And we use a very sophisticated technology building that, which I'll tell you later. And so he built a simple model, three structures, and people played with those and they liked them. Then they said, let's go ahead. So they built another iteration. Now it's gone from 8 pages to 48 pages, so it's getting a lot more fidelity to it. And he accidentally placed it on an external web page and told a customer about it. So he could get a real customer feedback. Got spanked and promised never do that again, but got some really great feedback. And then did the detailed version, which is 148 screens. That's a lot of web space and code. And the investment was less than 2% of the overall development, less than 2%. We believe that IBM actually bought the company having seen the mock-up. How is this done? Interactive PowerPoint. No fancy tools. How do we make sure it's authentic? Because, you know, basically when you're looking at websites around the world, it takes time to sweep all his websites. So if you go click and the page comes back full, instantly you're going to have a complete phony experience. So it has good engineering behind it about the performance of all the page accesses and so on. Even some engineering code that built the prototype to see how long it would take to fill that page to know whether even the UI model was reasonable for doing that. 2% of the overall effort. How many story cards is that? Come on, folks. Let's put this on story cards. You are, you know, good stuff. You know, get serious about story cards. You know. And then you throw them all away. That's really useful. Come on back. You know, here's my project. A dump of story cards. How do you maintain this stuff? Come on, agilists, get serious. We cannot scale or build products if we can't have documentation. I see that's allowed. I was so excited to see a sketching talk here. We're making progress in modern agile. You're now allowed to sketch. What a cool idea. Sketching is a key part of envisioning. This, to me, is the biggest things coming. But what this does is save you from building the wrong thing. So you can fail fast, very quickly, using very inexpensive, because there's no code here. Refactoring is really easy. Refactoring is, of course, a joke for large software. Refactoring uses great hype and the dance. And for people that are really good, like Joshua and the people he trains, they can actually do the. But when you get to these large, large corporate code bases, there's no chance that you're going to do these serious refactorings. They're very high risk and very difficult. So for individual teams, the refactoring is key. And if they do it all along, you won't get those big, ugly code bases. But when you do have one, do not be confused to say, how many of you worked on a project said, we told them, it's all right, we're going to refactor it, because you knew refactoring is a good word. But what you really said, we're going to tear the whole thing apart, rewrite it and restructure it. And you were lying when you said, this is not an equivalence-preserving refactoring. It's a rewrite. Those are very dangerous. So envisioning can save you. So the key thing when building software of high value is to find a really fast and simple way to do it, because you need to cheat. Because if you build most software the way you're supposed to, you're never going to get it done. At least not going to get it done in the time scale I have to get it done. And if I can't show short time to value, I'm not going to get the business. And I'm going to be out there competing with all these other smart people who can probably program better than I can. So what I have to use is to use my head to try and find, is there a way I can cheat? So the fastest way to make things better is to change the way the business works. Many people never bother to ask. Like, why do we have this process? Good question. But most of the time, people don't walk upstairs and talk. I've been and gone and talked to lawyers and said, this doesn't make any sense to me, but I'm told that you people reject anything like that. They go, makes perfect sense to me. I say, can you give me a letter saying we don't need to do this? Sure. Again, no code required. Very easy. Change the business. The other big thing, of course, is programming's been saved by years by the hardware engineers who build faster hardware. And today, hardware is amazing. So with today's hardware, you can simplify all sorts of problems. I'll come back to these. Improve software. There are better ways to do things. You know, database technology has changed a lot. We have machines, lots of machines that can have lots of processes. We don't all have to live in the same memory space anymore. In the old days, we had to link the whole ugly thing together. Now we can make it into independent small processes. Be careful, of course, of the microservice trap, which is to take your large tarball and put it into a nicely set of dependency-preserving microservices. So no longer can you release either, because they've all got version signatures and they all depend on each other, which is something I see. Congratulations in microservices. Bad news, it's got all the same problems you had before. So you have to understand the... So new languages help. And I guess that's my kind of problem, as I'm kind of a language addict. Because I found that the amount of code I have to write is the amount of code I have to maintain. So if I can find a language which will let me express myself, then I have less code. I mean, if I get in, one of the reasons I can't deal with Java, and God forbid I did build a Java VM and an Eclipse IDE, my apologies for that. You know, I also was a
founder of the Agile Alliance, so I owe you, I've lied to sin, so you don't want to hear what I'm doing now. I won't tell you. You don't want to go there. And improved practices. And one I'll mention today is property-based testing. So testing is still 30 to 50% of development, and I subscribe to the test soon principle, that is the time between when the test and the code is written should be short. I don't want to argue whether you have to write it first or slightly after or during or whatever, but it's soon. But however, code inspections are really good. You can find hundreds of bugs using code inspections. Remember, the principle from Lean is collective ownership, which is, I call four eyes on the code. Woody calls it, 16 eyes. And mob programming is a wonderful example, very appropriate at certain points of time for having increased sharing or for achieving collective ownership. So the principle from Lean is collective ownership. Pair programming is one way to do that. So are code inspections, so are design reviews, so is mob programming. Don't get hung up on one. Now, who would like to write all the code in their system twice? Who wants to write everything twice? Well, that's why you use Cucumber, isn't it? So you can write all the tests once, have them all break when you make any change, and do this other. Why do we do these tools? I mean, BDD as a thinking process is great. But come on, you can automate almost all the code that comes in. You don't need to write all those silly tests that break and fail. Big problem in unit testing. Not a big problem for module testing or component testing or acceptance testing. One of the best techniques I know for high-risk systems is side-by-side comparison of two independent implementations. This is my favorite really strong technique. Independent programming teams basically build the system twice and they test the results. Or they build the test part independently without access to the other code. Been used for years in things like NASA and so on. It's actually not that hard to do. You consider how hard it is to write all these tests. Sometimes it's easier to write the system twice because the programmers like writing code, they don't like writing tests. So this is my favorite technique for really serious code. For UI, I love Selenium, I love all that, but when you're doing something complicated, I tend to build things that look like IDEs, sorry. They're very hard to test with something like Selenium. And we keep changing them, making them worse each release, adding features we don't need. Right? That's what big companies do, right? Supposedly because it's hard to talk to our users, but we can measure. The problem is, it's very hard to actually keep up with the changing UI. So the tests are almost always fragile. If you're fortunate and can do functional testing and you've got a business sort of thing, that's a wonderful thing. I learned a product here called Saatchi, which I think would be very useful for a lot of the IT companies. But for doing the kinds of UIs that I'm involved, which are very complicated, we have a very simple approach, which we've been using for 20 years, and it's very simple. As soon as any significant amount of code goes into the system, into the UI, we freeze the code base, everyone uses the component they're not been working on, they bang on it for 2 or 3 days, we get hundreds of bugs, off by 4 pixels, the 15th item in the menu doesn't work. Why do we have 15 items in a menu? I don't know. That's the first problem, but we try and identify those things and get rid of them. Within 3 days after, all those bugs are closed. None of those bugs are ever gonna come back. If I wrote tests for those bugs, they would be useless. They would just load my test. This is the best practice, and it works, and it produces very, very stable code because there's lots of just accidental stupid bugs in UIs, and I don't have any faith that any other technique is going to do. But by far the best testing tool today is something called property-based testing. And if you go away from nothing else today and you care about the quality of your software, I encourage you to look at property-based testing. It's available for every programming language on the planet. Comes from something called QuickCheck, which was written by John Hughes for Haskell. You essentially write a specification or a model of your program, and given the model of the program, it generates tests that conform to that model randomly, so it's really good at shaking all the edge cases essentially, by writing one spec, you get 1,000 unit tests, or 10,000 unit tests, or 1,000,000 unit tests. Really, really useful. Of course, the problem with random testing is you get millions and millions of tests that fail. And you go, oh, thanks, right? That's like find bugs, right? Find bugs is great, except it finds way too many bugs. So you don't know which are the good ones. Which ones do I need to fix? Because most code has way more bugs than you should you believe in. So in the end, it's only about fixing the ones that matter. Expensive ones, ones that impact customers. So the big thing that John did is he put in something called shrink. And what it does is it finds the smallest failing test. So it finds a sequence of operations that causes it to fail and isolates it down to that test. This is just fantastic. I don't have time to go into talking about how it works or some, but it's been used on some very, 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 React is a distributed database. It has like 95% code coverage written by a team of PhDs. Within 2 weeks, John's team found 8 critical bugs in React. That should also tell you something if you try and use distributed databases, but I don't have time to comment on that. If God had believed in distributed databases, he would not have concentrated all the brain in the head and connected the rest of the body with a slow bit serial interface. Quote IP Sharp. So this two things, I think, dog fooding and property-based testing, are the essence for us, our success. The other thing is simplicity, right? We need to find a simple way to do things. So fast software equals fast hardware plus simplicity. And simplicity, to use Martin Thompson's wonderful term, is typically about essentially mechanical sympathy or software sympathy, understanding how the system, the code, and the architecture go together and flow. So today's hardware is very fast. You can go to a website, I think this is Dell, for $15,000 you can buy a computer with 1 terabyte of RAM, 100 terabytes of disk, and 64 cores. There are many businesses in the world that can run their entire business on this computer. All universities in India could run on this computer, no problem. They won't ever do it, but they could. This immediately means you can do automated build and test. You could also go to Amazon and spend a lot of money, way more than this, using Amazon instances, which is the fashion, but I don't have time to talk about that. Hardware is very cheap. That's why Amazon's making so much money, charging you for using their cheap hardware. All the interesting data is in memory. We have customers with machines with 10 terabytes of RAM. Next year, you're going to be able to get 10 terabytes in your PC of non-volatile memory. Think about it. I am convinced that within 5 years, 10 years, programming will be essentially reduced to query. You see this now. People doing very sophisticated things like compiler analysis and so on, points to analysis, optimizing compile. Very sophisticated algorithm. Do it now through queries. Data log, extended SQL dialects, and so on. Unfortunately, the one thing we don't teach people in computer science or software engineering is how to do queries. But that's what we're all doing today. Very important. You want to understand how to do query and what the meaning of joining data and working it together. These machines are very, very, so the nice thing is now when you've got a machine that's really fast and it's got lots of memory, all those contortions, algorithms, you know, goofy libraries, you know, oh, I need to implement my own red black trees because I learned in CS that was really cool, or I want to use this buggy open source framework because my friends are using it. You can actually do things very simple. You can do linear search. Why is the kind of technology I use fast? Because it's in harmony or sympathy with the hardware. Hardware is not round. It's not objects. It's rectangular. The registers are rectangular, the memory's rectangular, the cache is rectangular, the disk is rectangular. And so as long as you traffic in what the machine does, you're going to be able to execute very, very fast. and it's going to be very simple. You don't have all this serialization garbage and everything like that. That goes, I mean, you know, any of you use things like Google Protocol Buffers or, God forbid, Avro or Parquet or anything like that? You do, but you don't want to admit it. You know? Well, it's just horribly slow and inefficient. If you're really working on a machine and want to use fast, what you want to do is just stick the data together with a count at the front. That's called a vector. And so that's how you get... The other thing is now we can do things with end-user computing. So we can actually compute over huge amounts of data, and end-users can do that. We don't need to get a Java programmer or a C-sharp programmer or a C++ programmer because the machines are plenty fast enough for doing that. We run spreadsheets on trillions of rows at blazing speed. Easily doable with today's technology. You would not believe how fast computers are. And they're way cheaper than programmers, even Indian programmers. Now, I don't know what you can get done for $15,000 in India, but I know I can get zero done in America for $15,000 by a programmer. Versus I can give this to an analyst, and they can be flying and living in their data. I'm serious. Many people could run their entire country on that one box because the interesting stuff is in memory. Look around. Things have changed. Now, the real serious problem in software is software. We have too much of it. Right? So the biggest waste is bloat. The biggest contributor to bloat is object-oriented programming and the associated languages. And frameworks basically bring in a whole lot of stuff you didn't care about into your program and give you all sorts of dependencies so that when you try and separate things out, you, by the time you've loaded five frameworks, you're in this tangled web that you can't remove things. That's because we should never let frameworks come out. We should have, they're supposed to be sealed components. So you really want to get rid of objects when you can. Because objects, by their very nature, and pointers or references, create tangled webs. I'm sorry, I did pimp object-oriented programming, but I did it with a lightened programming language called Smalltalk that even normal people could use. But then, of course, the industry brought you the very best in things like Java and C#. I would gladly take your 110 million lines of COBOL and give you my 10 million my 1 million lines of Java. I would make a lot of money. Java legacies are very, very scary. And they're not possible to refactor unless you've been doing it all along. So there are some very old techniques. When I graduated, which was a long time ago, the badge of honor was to learn something called table-driven programming. I have to call it TDP because TDD is already taken. But these are actually really understood by BAs, devs, and so on. They're very modular, and they're all data-driven, so you can change them without, you know, rebuilding the system. You can even live change them on the fly. This is at the core of many very successful systems. You know, if you're in a bank, you may have heard people go, oh, we use this old piece of garbage called Hogan. Terrible old banking system. I don't know why they use this stupid old system. Because it's all table-driven, you can change it, you can introduce a new product, new banking, very easily, no code required. Data modularity is much more important. Moving data is much harder than moving code, unless you're trying to change the code. You want to change the code, then it's much harder. So they're used in all sorts of applications, and these are some of the common ones. Decision tables is a fantastic technique for working with users to do this, and I'll describe some case studies. Reducing it, you know, basically integration, the whole notion of integrated came up with this notion of, in order to put things together, what you need is APIs. Here's all my APIs, and to make it easy for you to use them, I've sorted them alphabetically. Thank you. And, you know, because I knew you'd want to be flexible, I gave you 10 different ways to do the same thing without telling you which one would be better in what circumstance. So my first answer is, if you're doing data integration, if you're doing integration, think data integration, just forget APIs. Just leverage the web or leverage the physical page format. It is easier to talk to SAP BW or Oracle Financials by reading the physical disk pages than it is to use the APIs. or to put an atom feed on top of it so it just comes out as a pub. Now you've got, you can use web tools. Or if you have an old technology and it really is hard to use, you can put an ODBC interface on it. Now anybody can talk to the ODBC and they can get their report out in Crystal Reports, whatever, or simple mashup tools. So just by putting a standard interface on, which is a data interface as opposed to a programming interface, you can get rid of thousands of complicated APIs. And of course, the APIs never really work anyway, right? Because they only give you half the data they want. Because they were added later, right? Somebody went along and said, we've got this big ugly mess. We're going to put some APIs in it. So you go around randomly drilling holes in it and pounding APIs in, which give you part of the stuff. So they're always low performance and low functionality. Loose coupling, of course, is the rage. And the key thing here is the APIs are value-based. We never want to pass references. We only want. So that's what component programming is really about, is APIs that take values. So we're going to a world of stateless things or immutability. You want to use the more fancy program. We're going back to a world of data flow, pipes and filters, occasionally disconnected. Many systems, it's easier just to replicate the data than it is to try and keep it up in real time. Because most query systems actually travel behind the real data anyway. You can, things like Erlang implement things very efficiently just using coroutines. These are the modern ways to do things, and they work very well. There's a very old architecture called batching. This is a notion that you have all sorts of people who try and get their website tuned and their database tuned, and they process every transaction in real time, and they get spin up all sorts of scale-out servers, and look at this, we can, and then, of course, you can't query them because they partition the data across all these servers, and you can't query across them, but we'll solve that problem by putting another layer in there and build a whole lot more infrastructure on top of that. But in practice, if you actually batch those queries, say, run 1,000 at a time, the users won't know the difference. You'll run all the queries in the same time it took you to run one. Batching is the secret to high-performance systems. And if you've never heard of Martin Thompson, I please encourage you to take a look at his Mechanical Sympathy blog and his most recent writing on batching. In the world that I come from currently, there's a very old technique of basically having all the data in the world available. This is what people have been doing in the stock market for years. What they have is all the data that happened today, all the ticks, every trade in the market, and they have all the historical database of all the ticks that happened since 1992 or whatever it was. Using these two files, you can do very efficient and scalable processing. And this has now come back as something called the Lambda architecture. Again, once it goes to California, it has to have a new name and a less efficient implementation in Java, called Hadoop. And then you basically have a real-time database and a batch database. This architecture scales. You can scale it out. It's very simple to use, and it's, because it's immutable, you don't have any kind of problems in recovery or things like that. Event sourcing is a closely related technology that's becoming quite hot. It's very simple relative to the previous sort of data technology. So if you're looking at data architecture, that's it. And please, please, do not ever output strings. Or if you do output strings, do not let them into your data, stored data. Using JSON or XML or CSV guarantees that your processing time will be 10x longer and that your storage costs will be 10x. And of course, if you're like most companies, you don't even put a version identifier in your JSON file. So when some goofball decides to change the JSON string, you can no longer look at data over time. Welcome to the job of data scientists. They're hacking Python scripts to remember that, oh yes, it was December 2nd when we added that other attribute to the UI testing, so we have to actually run the different program, and we've got all these different Python programs strung together in our data pipeline because we can't version our schemas, or we don't have a schema. NoSQL is one of the biggest ripoffs of all time. It makes it really easy for programmers who don't want to understand data to write it, and it makes it absolutely hell to store and process. So if you are a person who writes a program that writes NoSQL, you should have to write every report that I have to get, take that data, because I have to parse that data. It's very expensive, process it and so on. This is just dumb, dumb, dumb. Please do not work with text. It'll never be fast. Oh, that was a, maybe there's a message here. So I'm not going to give you the functional programming talk because I'll have to talk about a monad and everyone will feel like they don't know math anymore and they feel bad. But the simplest way to program is to basically work with collections. What do most mobile applications do? Why is mobile programming so hard? In the end, all they do is they put a collection on the screen from which you pick. Most programs just work with collections. That's one of the problems with object-oriented programming. We got carried away, and every time we had a collection, we made it into a class and gave it a name and made things very complicated. In practice, all we're really working with data structures and functions. So today, the fashion is to use filter, reduce, and other idioms that come from functional programming. You do not have to buy into all the type theory and everything else associated with functional programming. Unfortunately, the Haskell community, which is a beautiful language, but where everyone is a math head, makes it difficult, because every time they talk to people, they make you feel bad that you didn't do well in math. Or if you did math, you didn't do the kind, you definitely didn't do category theory. But more and more, the world is able to do things with data, particularly big data and functions. The reason that functional programming is finding is not parallel computing, it's working with data. Because most data is very simple. I take it from the disk, I filter it, I chop it, and I put it on the screen. Someone decides something about it, I do the transformation back. It's straightforward ETL. And there are lots of languages that are doing this. I strongly recommend you look at some of these. I didn't put my own, well, I did. There's a strange language I use, Q there. I'm not recommending you do that. Every other language I pimped to you was obviously the wrong thing to do. Why should you follow me again? So pick one of these other ones. But try and pinch something similar. And of course, Python and these other languages, JavaScript, they're all very much headed that way. So that's some technology. Let's talk about the sort of business side of it. How do I find out where to put my 3 months of effort? What I look for are for innovation opportunities or insertion points. And the places I look for them most often is where the data rests or flows. The last thing I want to do is touch code. Whereas most people, when they go at something, what they want to do is change the code. Change the code's really hard. I worked a lot with Michael Feathers. I know that Michael Feathers walks away from big refactoring projects, as many others, because they're just too hard. But most interesting places, the other thing is data flowing and value flows, value streams, are often very closely related in computer systems. So there are lots of places, this is just a partial list. Sometimes I'll actually go to the code. If it's a real compute bottleneck, small piece of code, there's a highly structured place where there's a lot of rules. There's a place where the code has to change all the time, and I'll change those into data-driven or table-driven pieces. Typically, performance stuff, I'll end up basically doing the kinds of tricks that Martin Thompson does, or I would hope to be able to do that. Once I find one of those points, then I can associate, I can typically connect the flow points very easily to the value chain. And given the value chain, then you can apply a transformation. So what I want to do in the last few minutes, I'm probably over slightly, but I'll make it quick, is just give you some examples. And I'm using some legacy systems because I actually believe there are some people in the audience that talked to me yesterday who actually work with legacy code. Now, I know all of you probably write new code all the time and are working in really cool new things, but most of my clients have code that makes them money and programmers that want to write new things that don't work. This is a large insurance company, and they had a new CIO who they basically lost $200 million rewriting the insurance application. It was one of those large consulting groups, you know. They're in the room, so I can't use their name. But, you know, they begin with I and A and C and things like that. And basically, big companies just rotate which one. After they get burned, then they get them, spin the wheel and get the next one, right? And they give them another $10 or $100 million project, which becomes a $300 million. I wish I knew how to sell those, but I don't. So they had a whole lot of legacy systems. They had a bunch of vendor-supplied things like rating engines and so on, printing systems for insurance forms, a bunch of enterprise applications, SAP, PeopleSoft, a whole bunch of integration services, a bunch of commercial infrastructure. And since the first big vendor starting with I was on this particular client, they had figured out that what they needed was a new object store and a high speed, at least they said it was high speed, bus, enterprise bus. This would be a SOA. And of course the CIO said, no, we're gonna do this agile. So we were brought in to sort of train the people with agile. And the first thing we found out is they didn't actually have any Java developers. But they found some C++ developers down the street, and a bunch of C# developers, and they sprayed them all green, and then sent them to a course with Bob Koss and Bob Martin, who I worked with at the time. And it was, the situation was pretty hopeless. And they said, well, there's no chance. They don't have any programmers. They've got all this stuff from vendors. The vendors are just fighting with each other. Not that your vendors would do that. Our vendors in America do that, but yours would all get along nicely, I know. And of course, they had a enterprise software bus. And I just said, well, we're done. We have to leave. We can't be successful here. And Jeff Eastman, who was working on the floor above, came running down and said, no, Dave, we have to stay. He said, these people are amazing. Turns out to be, they were in a part of America which is very stable. So these people have been working, you know, the business analysts and so on, the domain experts, they were very rich in domain experts. They actually understood insurance intimately, all different kinds of insurance, commercial, personal. And they actually had everything, you know, for years, because they'd been supposed to write the specs, but of course everyone was busy building all the technology, so each time the project got canceled, they just kept working on another kind of insurance. And they built these huge tables. They had Excel sheets that used all the columns going across in Excel. They knew the domain. Wow. So the first thing we did is we taught them how to cut their Excel, you know, modular Excel, how to cut the Excel sheets up so you didn't have to scroll them or try and figure out how to clip all the paper together. And then we basically said, you know, these things can all be basically described by tables, decision tables, validation tables, and they've got it all done. They've got the spec. And of course, the agile guy said, oh, great, let's go. We'll have some story cards. Let's start doing this. I said, wait, we can just take the specs and generate all the code. Because remember, I'm very lazy. And I want to get out of there quickly and get my check. Go to the next project. So we generated all the code, had a small team that built the interfaces to the enterprise bus, and then basically delivered it to the acceptance test. The other thing is we forced all the vendors that were delivering to the system to run acceptance tests in the contract. You cannot pass your process across the contract, but you can pass the fact that if you deliver with acceptance tests, I will give you the check right away. If you don't deliver with the acceptance test, I will give you the check when I have a chance to try it. And that is IBM's policy for an A-class vendor versus other vendors who have to wait to get their check. So your contract can deal with vendors that don't use a process compatible with yours. This is a system, HR bottleneck. Kent Beck worked on this one. It was a company in Chicago. They do complicated HR policies. When they negotiate with the union, they have to implement within so many days. Very complicated. The analysts do everything in Excel. They had 100 COBOL devs implementing the code. they came in and they did it in small talk, which is amazing, and they got 15%, trained everybody in small talk. Look, we're using the new tools, we're using the new process. What did I say about systemic change? Not much different. But again, Kent looked at this and said, oh, everything's already coded. It's just coded in Excel. And as you know, Excel is not always the most disciplined programming language. So what they did is they wrote a rule checker to basically put constraints on the Excel sheets so that they could take the Excel directly from the analyst. Then they wrote a spreadsheet, first in Smalltalk, it runs today in Java, that runs in the mainframe, talking to the COBOL programs. And they were able to redeploy the COBOL programmers to work on other things that need to be done in the business. And now they can make changes relatively instantly because the whole thing is data-driven. You see a pattern to this. A simple engine that actually does the work, that automates a key part of the development process, that reduces the time to do this. It works over and over and over again. This is a large data migration. This is a factory automation system. You know about factory automation, it's very expensive. You've got all this heavy equipment, and it's all proprietary, and you can't change it. You've got $300 million worth of Allen Bradley or Rockwell or whatever gear talking to all your factory equipment, and it's all proprietary, and they basically change the standard so they can patent something that puts the pins in the wrong place. It's a nasty business. What we did is we put in a TCP/IP card because they're proprietary of us, and then we just turned everything into HTTP and Atom feeds. Now all the UI, all the fancy control system stuff could be done by people that knew how to use the web. Trivial change, no massive UI development. Last thing, and I'll finish here, last project I worked on was a system for doing cyber analytics, basically trying to identify bad guys in cyberspace. And what we had to do is support people that are using fast data. So we're working interactively in tens to hundreds of terabytes, interactive response in 10 to hundreds of terabytes, which you can do on modern hardware. And we wanted to make it possible to work with both the live data and the past data, because if you're looking for something like a bot, the way many things work in security is they have a window and they look there and they see, if they see, you know, someone's doing port scan or doing something bad in that window, then they shut them down or try and do that. The problem is, if you have sophisticated cyber attacks, when they want to set up a botnet or something like that, they actually hide in the regular stream. And so they set up over months. To find those, you have to look at not only the real-time data, but you have to look at all the historical data. So in general, what you have to do is use queries that go against both that data. So that's kind of the problem in a high level. And we basically build a system that has both analysts and programmers model, because in this case, the people who are using this is like an IDE, but it's designed for normal people as opposed to programmers. And those people have very different backgrounds. So essentially, we have a set of tools on top that makes it easy, like spreadsheets, except the spreadsheets can work on a trillion rows of data, and visual tools with the high-speed rendering. And then we do all this stuff underneath. To do this, the only technology we could use that was fast enough and compact enough, because we actually run in the network as well as in the cloud, was a vector functional programming language, which to me is the most powerful technology I've ever used. I can write programs that are very small and very fast. So I love it. And I'm not telling it to you because it's too hard and you'd just be the wrong thing. If you start using it, and many people do, then it'll obviously go bad like Smalltalk and Java and other things like that. So I don't want you to do that. And so there's a very fast and simple infrastructure running at the bottom. The entire execution engine is 80K bytes, that's the database, the programming language, the TCP stack, ODBC, everything in it. So it's very compact and very fast, again, close to the metal. And so we were able to build this with a team of 6 people, front end JavaScript, and it's easily the complexity of Eclipse. Thank you, I'm sorry if I went over time and took away from your teeth.
Right, thanks a lot, Dave. One of the reasons I really, really wanted Dave to come here is, as you guys would have seen,
I mean, he's obviously done a lot of cool stuff, you know, much before a lot of other folks. But he also continues to lead a lot of interesting stuff, right, from whatever is happening right now in terms of bleeding edge stuff. And I think having someone kind of open the talk for the day helps people to think about scaling in a different way. You don't necessarily have to think of scaling processes, but scaling other kinds of things. And I think you've done a wonderful job to help people understand some of those thought processes, and really appreciate that.
Thanks very much.